Morning. Well, welcome to New Hope, and if you're a guest here today, welcome, and feel free to fill out a visitor's card. We'd love to get some information, just so that we can send you some information about what we do here, not just here on Sundays, but also throughout the week, all the activities that we do. We've got a few announcements to make, starting with 1040i, so 1040 Initiative out in the Ivory Coast right now. There's four of our people out there, along with 70-ish other people, doing a lot of work. They had good fortune the first week that the heat wasn't too bad. They had pretty good weather. I think in the evenings it was pretty, or at night it was pretty cool. But it's starting to heat up a little bit. They're in the second week, so they're getting tired. So this is going to be the trying week for them. So we need to step up prayers for this week for the 1040 Initiative team out in the Ivory Coast. Shelley spoke to Tim this morning. They went to church service. Tim preached at the same church that he preached at last year. And he baptized 12 people this morning. So that's excellent. It's also the same place last year where they witnessed the burning of the fetishes or idols that people have over in the villages there. And that's kind of their security blanket that they have against evil spirits over there. So it's a huge deal for them to do that. And Shelley witnessed it last year, and 3.5 years ago I witnessed it in a different village, and it's quite something to watch. They give all their trust to Christ, and they burn the thing that they think is protecting them from evil spirits, and it's just it's a huge step for them to take. It's much bigger than a lot of people's step here. I mean, it's just so different than what they're used to. So Shelley posed an interesting question this morning. So what would our fetishes be? What would we have trouble putting into a fire and burning, the things that keep us comfortable? So just something to think about this week. So other activities that are going on around the church.
I have to use my outside voice now. Young adults, 25 to 40. On February 21st at 5 o'clock, we've got Tim and I will be doing less than an hour. We'll be talking and receiving information from you, just chatting about what the future of the church is for that generation. So please feel free to come to that. There will be childcare, there will be food, and we will, like I say, we'll try and keep it to less than an hour so that we don't keep you too long. The men's conference, the R3 conference, that's Revive, Restore, and Relaunch, is on March 12th. Tickets for that are still available, $48. If you want a ticket, come to the office or see me. And that's at New Covenant Church. We have a couple of clipboard items. There's Grief Share. That starts February 16th and 17th, so two sessions, Tuesdays and Wednesdays. Also underneath that is a Mexico Missions sign-up sheet, which is Pastor Chris talked a little bit last week about the fact that we're doing a little bit differently this year. So if you're used to getting a lot of letters from kids that want sponsorship for Mexico, then you might not get them this year. You have to sign up for it. And this is to kind of streamline the process so you don't end up with a lot of letters. That, you know, it's a little frustrating, and then you end up sponsoring somebody because everybody wants money. So sign up on the sign-up sheet, and then you'll get a letter. And if you're used to sponsoring a kid every year, then put their name on there, and we'll make sure that that information gets to the youth department. And I'm sure they're pretty tired this morning. Chris, Teddy, and Brittany, they got back really late last night from Mexico. It was another planning session down there. So hopefully, well, Teddy's here, so... also, seniors' luncheon is this Tuesday, so 55 plus. Seniors' luncheon this Tuesday. If you've never been, consider coming. It's a great time, and you don't have to bring food the first time you come. So that's well worth considering for your calendar. Sunday school teachers still need them. 5th, 6th, 3rd, 4th. If you're interested in teaching, let Jennifer know or let someone know in the office. We really do need more Sunday school teachers. Paul's going to talk on a video a little bit later about women's luncheon, so I won't get into that too far at the moment. Something else that's going on this month, on February 23rd, that's a Tuesday, is the President Clovis Prayer Breakfast. Starts at 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. Keynote speaker Chuck Swindoll, who's a pastor out of Texas, but has published tons of books since the 1970s, so it should be a really good keynote speaker. We have 21 tickets, actually we have 19 left right now, so if you have, if anyone wants one, raise your hand right now. They are $15, and it's on Tuesday, February 23rd.
With you today, but I'm in Hawaii on a missions trip. Okay, well, I'm on a trip. But here's the good news. Today, out in the pavilion, we have the tickets for our women's spring luncheon on sale. We're going to have such a great time this year. It's on February 27th at noon in the bridge. We're going to have a wonderful lunch buffet prepared for you, Our special guest speaker is Mary Pearson from Calvin Crest Retreat. She always does a fantastic job. And we're just going to have a lot of fun hanging out and visiting together. Now, don't hesitate. Tickets are limited. Get out there today and get them. They're only $10 each, so maybe you can get one for a friend. But anyway, join us because we're going to have a wonderful time. And if you want to look really cool like me, contact Teddy Miller. He's got these for sale and he can hook you up. What?
I thought you were promoting the women's luncheon.
Well, I did. Tickets are on sale for $10 each. We're going to have a great time. I just thought people might want to look cool like I do.
Sounds like Teddy put you up to that.
No. Okay, no money exchanged hands in that promotion, okay? Is that better?
Say aloha.
Aloha.
We get to talk about Psalm 15 today. Psalm 15. Psalm 15 has some things to do with being honest with ourselves.
What?
Am I hearing things? Oh my gosh.
This is the voice.
Oh my gosh. It's good. Wow. We're going to talk about going up the hill and talking to God in a second. Let's slow down, okay? Wow. So Psalm 15 has some things to do with being honest with ourselves, with others, and more importantly with God, because that has a profound impact on our relationship. The Psalms pretty closely tied to Pastor Robert's time with us last week on Psalm 13, which I was grateful for. There is a song by Francesca Battistelli called If We Are Honest. And the words to that song are, truth is harder than a lie, the dark seems safer than the light, and everyone has a heart that loves to hide. I'm a mess, and so are you. We built walls nobody can get through. Yeah, it may be hard, but the best thing we could ever do, bring your brokenness, and I'll bring mine, because love can heal what hurt divides, and mercy's waiting on the other side, if we're honest. Don't pretend to be something that you're not, living life afraid of getting caught. There is freedom found when we lay our secrets down at the cross. It would change our lives. It would set us free. It's what we need to be. Amen. So let's consider or contemplate less pretending and more authenticity, less fear and more love, less hiding and more abiding. So let's start with by reading here Psalm 15. The Psalm of David, Lord, who may dwell in your sanctuary, who may live on your holy hill, he whose walk is blameless, and he who does what is righteous, who speaks the truth from his heart and has no slander on his tongue, who does his neighbor no wrong and casts no slur on his fellow man, who despises a vile man but honors those who fear the Lord, who keeps his oath even when it hurts, who lends money without usury and does not accept a bribe against the innocent. He who does these things will never be shaken. Benjamin Franklin described this as the gentleman's psalm, because this is what the life of an upright man should look like, or more importantly, what the life of a Christian man or woman should look like. And it focuses largely on that idea of personal integrity, that the Christian man or woman is somebody who is obedient to God, who doesn't speak poorly against other people, who has truth in their hearts, who puts the interests of others above themselves. So when I read this, I think, why did David write this? And I don't really know. But after thinking about it, I thought maybe this was a time of self-reflection or examination, perhaps similar to Psalm 13. Maybe he felt distance from God and was asking, how do I dwell with you? Maybe this is how he maintained accountability with God. We know in Psalm 139, David says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting." We know that David is a man after God's own heart, and so we see that in this Psalm 15. So let's start at the beginning of the psalm, because that's my very favorite part. I like this version. It came from a devotional. I don't know which version it is, probably New King James or something, or King James. But it says, "O Lord, who may abide in your tent," because I love the word abide. "O Lord, who may abide in your tent, who may dwell on your holy hill." These words bring about different images, right? One is Moses going up on the hill and abiding with God for 40 days, receiving directions about the building of the tabernacle, the Ten Commandments. And after this time with God, he comes down the hill, and Exodus 34:29 says, "He was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord." At first, they were afraid to talk with Moses because they were like, "What? You're freaking us out a little bit." And they started to leave, and he said, "Wait, come back. I have some things to tell you. I look like this because I just spent all this time with God, and I'm going to share that with you." Another image is that of the tabernacle. David wrote this before the temple was built, so the tabernacle was like a big tent, right? So who may dwell or who may abide in your tent? So we get this idea of the tabernacle. And inside the tabernacle, in the center, in the most holy place, was the Ark of the Covenant. And with that Ark of the Covenant was the Shekinah glory, that visible presence of God right there amongst his people. So those are those images that we see. And David is saying, "O Lord, who may abide in your tent, who may dwell on your holy hill, how can I get in these spaces with you?" I think it's important to distinguish that this is not about heaven and salvation, because that is not contingent on us and our behavior and us being the upright Christian man. That's about God and what God has done for us, right? Salvation is first. Salvation, we hear in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. He is our righteousness. The redemption and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, though, should be evident in our walk with him. Galatians 2:20 says, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing." So we do not live in obedience or demonstrate personal integrity to earn God's love. But because God loves us, and the Holy Spirit resides in us. So this dwelling and abiding with God that we're talking about here is about a relationship with God, the knowing God, the experiencing his presence. And I like the word abide because it does have these two meanings. There's abide, which does mean to obey. I will abide by your laws. And then there's the abiding, which is that dwelling, living with, the closeness. And that's what I think David is talking about here. My youngest daughter knows all about abiding, not so much the rule-following abiding, but the other kind of abiding. If you spend much time with me and my children, you'll notice that the youngest one is like attached at all times. And in that moment, you know that time where you're like trying to go somewhere and trying to get keys and find your purse and where's my jacket, and I just will feel something here. And this something is not helping me find anything. This something's not looking for my keys. And I'll eventually trip or step on and say, "What are you doing?" And she says, "I just want to be with you." And I go, "I'm trying to find my keys." Which is not nice, but so she knows all about just wanting to be close, right? Just be in space with. The answer to David's question, "Who may abide in your tent?" sounds a lot like the Ten Commandments. So when I wrestle with law versus grace and man's way versus God's design, I go back to creation because this was God's original intent before the fall. And then I look at Jesus' words and actions because this was the answer to the fall. So we can start with Adam and Eve and God. They must have abided with one another, spent time together, walked in the garden together. We see hints of that in the verses. Abiding. Would you describe your relationship or experience with God as abiding? And if not, it raises the question of why. And perhaps this is where David found himself, wondering why he was not abiding with God, and so he was contemplating. And his answers have something to do with being truthful and transparent to yourself, others, and God, to be upright and dependable. So what keeps us from being truthful and transparent? I would typically describe myself as a transparent person. I'm not incredibly shy. I think what you see is what you get. That's how I would describe myself. I value realness in others. Typically, if I ask you how you are, I want like an answer. Unless I'm walking away from you at that time, then it is a general, you know, greeting. But typically, if I ask you, hey, how are you? I'm looking for like, what? Hi, how are you? But in the last 5 years or so, I've had a couple of experiences at work in particular that have been like those nasty magnifying glasses that have the fluorescent light on them that show you all the things you don't really want to see. I've had those experiences that have made me realize that maybe I'm not quite as what you see is what you get as I thought that I was. I never really realized how isolated as a teacher you could make yourself. Typically, you can kind of control how much time you spend with particularly maybe your boss or even coworkers. If you're having a bad day, you can kind of, we try to not do that very often, but you can. There's a little bit of hiding that can take place. So when I got my first job as an administrator and went to my office, I realized I shared a wall with this first principal. And we could hear through the wall. I mean, there was no hiding. Everywhere I went, he was there. And he was very into transparency and honesty. And I realized this trust relationship was important in this role. So about a week and a half into working there, I go out to my car to get something, and I'm walking back, and I'm about to cross the quad to go use the restroom. Now, I'm transparent, but I'm pretty private, and the bathroom stuff is like nobody's business, okay, like that. That's private. Well, I'm walking, and he says, "Hey, Corey, where are you going?" And I said, "Wherever I want." Because that's appropriate, right? Who says that to their boss? Like the first couple weeks, wherever I want. And then I kind of laugh like, I'm funny. And then the people he's standing with who don't know me very well, I hear one guy go, "Oh, I didn't know you hired my wife to work here." And they laugh. And then the principal laughs. And I thought, okay, whew, like I got away with this, right? Well, then we had these other couple of moments where, and so thankfully that principal finds me endearing, right? He sees me as daughter-like and cute. So I got away with some of that behavior. And so then there were these other moments where we would be standing in the quad and he would ask me these questions, and they were appropriate, they were work-related, and I just would maybe not want to answer him. And so I would make a joke and he'd say, "I'm not joking, I'm serious." Like, and he'd ask me this question. And I'd look at him, and he'd say, "I don't know what this is." And I'd say, "What do you mean? What are you talking about?" And he says, "Your face. I don't know what this is." And then we'd have a bizarre conversation or an argument. But anyways, so we worked it all out. We got to know each other. And then I got a new principal who was my same age. So then I started to freak out. Like, he's not going to think I'm endearing. I can't be daughter-like. What am I going to do when he finds out I'm apparently, I don't know what this is, and I do whatever I want. So this new principal is walking the campus with Mr. Darling, the old principal, and the VP, and I walk into the library because I'm kind of curious about what they're doing. And the new principal says, "So what do you do?" And I laughed, because that's appropriate, right? And he says, "No, really, what do you do?" And I froze, because I was embarrassed that I couldn't put it into words. And the Mr. Darling and the VP say, they laugh, "Oh, she's great, you'll see later," and they walk away. And I thought, I don't know how long I'm gonna last here now. And so then I did what most hardworking folk do, and I avoided him. I just bolted in busyness, right? I was really busy all the time. I always had a kid in my office. I was always going somewhere. I just avoided this whole situation completely. And then one day we're in his office, and we'd kind of gotten to know each other and talking about something, and I say, "Well, I am the nicest person on campus." And he laughs. And I look at him, and he says, "Oh, you really believe that?" And I said, "What? What do you think of me?" Right? And so we have kind of this odd conversation. And in that conversation, I hear defiant and difficult to read, which are not words that I, what is all this, right? Those are not ways I would typically describe myself. So don't worry, we worked out the defiant, scary. We worked this out. Mr. Darling came here, pulled Pastor Tim aside. We told Pastor Tim, this new principal thinks I'm defiant. Mr. Darling says, "You know her well. She's an interesting one. What do you think about her?" I told the principal, this is what Mr. Darling says, I told the new principal, "She's not defiant. I just say she does whatever she wants whenever she wants." Because that's helpful too, right? So then Tim says, I like to call her independent. So if you're wondering what's wrong with me, we can blame my parents and my pastor for indulging me that I have been independent and I might do whatever I want whenever I want. Because it's independent, and I value that trait. So we worked, the new principal and I eventually worked out this defiant. He no longer would describe me as defiant. But I was wrestling with this, "I don't know what this is," and difficult to read comments, because that's not how I thought that I was. So I started to question why. Where was this coming from? And really what it came down to was issues of, there was the embarrassment piece, right? I was a little embarrassed in the beginning. And then the other issues came down to fear and trust. I'm like 3 pages ahead here. I did not trust them with my truth. I was scared that my best would not be good enough, that I would be judged or not accepted, or that I was replaceable. And in all honesty, with man, those things are possible, right? Man might reject us, but if you don't take that risk or enter into that relationship, you will possibly miss out on something very important. But the good thing is that God is not man, and he is the perfect recipient of our truth. Amen. So my youngest daughter, again, she's lovely, isn't she precious? My youngest one also taught me another reason why we may not always be truthful. There was this day when I walked into a room, and there was like 5 people in the room, and somebody says, "She said blah, blah, blah," and it was not a very nice thing. Well, there was like 5 people in the room, so I certainly did not assume my child said it, right? So I didn't really address it. Well, then like a month later, I'm in my house, and my oldest, Callie, says, "Oh, that was like when Natalie said blah, blah, blah." And I said, "Natalie said it." And so then I call in Natalie. I'm calm. I'm not going to get crazy yet. I just want to address it. A simple teaching moment, right? That simple teaching moment turned into the entire afternoon. I was exhausted by the end of it because all I said was, "Hey, honey, did you say blah, blah, blah?" And she says, "No." Like, I totally know you did. So let's work this out. It's okay. You're not in trouble. I just want to talk about it. So then I used all my strategies, which involve a lot of threats and yelling and isolation and something similar to a detective movie. I know you did it. You know I did it. You'll feel better when you just tell me you did it, right? Like all of that. So coercion, bribery, like all of it. And she still's like, I'd leave her for a minute, give her space to think, come back. Well, other people said it. Okay, but so then finally she starts to cry, and I understood. And she says, I think I might have said it. And I understood that she was not telling the truth, not because she was afraid or because she was going to get in trouble or because she did not trust me, but because she felt shame. She was hurt that she had hurt somebody else, so she didn't want to take responsibility for having possibly hurt somebody else. So why are we not honest with ourselves, others, and God? Fear, trust, shame. So we go back to the garden, right? Where God is looking for Adam and Eve after they have eaten of the tree, which they were not supposed to do. He gives them a chance to confess and restore that relationship. And what does Adam do? He tries to cover it up. He hides. He avoids. Genesis 3:8 says, then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, where are you? And he answered, I heard you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. Which was not the real reason why he was hiding. He knew he had disobeyed God. And God said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from? Telling him, look, I already know what you did, so let's just work this out. So then man says, well, the woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree and I ate it. So now he's going to blame. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? And the woman says, well, the serpent deceived me and I ate. So still a lack of true acceptance of that responsibility. But God clothes them with skin and he covers their shame. We can trust God with our truth because he knows it already. And he hasn't covered our sin. He has cast our sin in a sea of forgetfulness and declares us holy. Amen? Amen. I have finished reading Jen Hatmaker. Those of you who went to the IF conference, you got to hear her, right? Isn't she fantastic? So this book is called For the Love, Fighting for Grace. I highly recommend it. It's wonderful. So while I was preparing for our time together today, I came across, I had been reading this, and then all of a sudden I get to her chapter that says, tell the truth. I thought, well, what does Jen Hatmaker have to say? And here is what she has to say. It is good to remember in community, and even better to practice individually, that light trumps darkness. If you're concealing a dark struggle, you guarantee its power if it is shrouded in secrecy. Buried, it is free to hinder you, grow in your imagination, and truncate your future. It can hold you back, destroy relationships, and break your spirit. It can absolutely wreak havoc on your authenticity as the inside contradicts the outside day after day, month after month. Secrets are wild and free in the dark. But when you drag that truth kicking and screaming into the glorious light, you can see it for what it is. It wasn't as menacing as it pretended. It isn't as uncommon as it claimed. It is actually sad and pathetic sitting there in the light, shriveling up and losing power over you. You said it out loud and no one dropped dead, so what can it still hold over you? Then your good people, maybe your small group, your family, right, your community, Then your good people blast their light on it, shining truth and love and compassion and understanding, and it withers even more. With every I am here, I've been there, and you aren't alone, and God has this, your scary truth gets less terrifying, less overwhelming, less paralyzing. It becomes fully exposed with no secrets left to threaten you. You are 2 Corinthians 4. Because although this darkness pressed you so hard, it did not crush you. Perhaps it struck you down, but look at you. You are not destroyed. You see that in the light. You are still standing. Sorry. If you are still breathing, there is hope. Amen and praise Jesus, right? So in my preparation for today, I came across a video called Make Time to Abide. I just love that word. And I thought that these people have been spying on me and like listening to things I've been saying to myself. And listen to the answer that this woman gives for why she finds herself not abiding with God. And you will see that it's less like the Ten Commandments to follow in order to be worthy, but it's more of a way to avoid the things that can get in the way of our personal relationship with God. So let's watch.
Being a mom of little kids, there are times that I personally struggle with sitting down to spend time with the Lord or to play a game or to play Legos or just to sit and be with my kids. I struggle with that when there's stuff to be done. There's always something else to be done. There's always more laundry, dishes, errands that need to be run, things that need to be fixed. There's just always something else to do. Just the other day, I was so focused on accomplishing all the tasks of my day that I neglected to, you know, relationally spend time with my family. There have definitely been times where we've had families over and I'm more concerned about their comfort than I am about, you know, spending time with them. Like, I'm more worried about is there enough food out? Is there enough drinks out? Is it the food they like? Is it the drinks that they like? I'm more concerned with hostessing and making sure everybody's happy and content that I don't get to sit down and sit with them and spend time with them. When I let busyness win, I don't spend time with the Lord. I don't make him a priority. It causes me to want to control things that I can't control, but I feel like I should. It makes me feel rushed. I am not able to fully engage with whatever it is I'm supposed to be doing at the time. And I get easily angered. I'm quick to speak and not quick to listen. I start thinking that I'm enough. I start thinking that I can do it all. I start thinking that I'm capable. And then, of course, I always wind up disappointing myself. When I feel spiritually dry, I feel tired. I just feel empty and I feel like I'm kind of swimming upstream. I know that I'm not in control ultimately. Like, he has given me abilities, right? And he wants me to use my gifts and my talents to serve others and my family. But when I start getting frantic, it's because I'm losing sight of him and I'm not abiding in him, and I think I'm truly in control when I'm not. And I'm grateful that, you know, I have a husband that loves me and points me to Christ, and I have a community group that, you know, I can confess that to. And so I find that the Lord has taught me a great deal about just trusting in him and in his plans for me. And I've learned the hard way plenty of times that it's more important to me to sit and abide with my Lord, to refresh my heart and get my mind and my heart kind of recentered where it needs to be.
Well said, right? We think about Mary and Martha in Luke 10, verse 38 through 42. It says that as Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." I love that Jesus had to deal with these tattlers, right? To tell her to help me. And Jesus says, Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. And those of us that are Marthas sometimes struggle with that, right? Lord, you still understand that. I get it. Like, I opened my home, and Mary sat at your feet, but there's still stuff to do, right? And Jesus says, I get that, but she's done what is better, and that is that the first thing that she did was sit at his feet. That was the first thing. And allowed him to speak with her, abide together, and that she would receive the direction from the Holy Spirit about what's best. I like how she talked about how this turns into control. These good intentions turn into this illusion of being in control. My small group, I told my small group I really just wanted to turn on our video number 7 of Chip Ingram's Balancing Life's Demands and say, hey, I get to speak with you this morning. Let's watch Chip Ingram on session number 7, because we've been doing a study called Balancing Life's Demands, which is about reprioritizing and sitting, figuring out how, some strategies for how to sit at Jesus' feet. I would be remiss if I ignored the description of the Christian man, because it matters. This is where we explore the words of Jesus to understand this more. For one, when Jesus was asked what the greatest commandment was, he replied, the first one is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and with all your strength. And the second is to love your neighbor as yourself. Sounds a little bit like the response to David on who may abide in your tent. The one who loves the Lord with the Lord his God with all of his heart and loves his neighbor as himself. Because we know that love isn't just having warm feelings towards our neighbor, right? Love is the actions in 1 Corinthians 13. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. This goes back to Psalm 15. What does that look like? What does the Christian man look like? How do people see the radiance of our abiding with God? They see someone who is obedient to God. They see someone who has truth in their heart and purity of heart, pure motives, doesn't speak against people, gossip and slander and try to puff themselves up by tearing down others. They see somebody who doesn't loan money for interest, but is looking out for the interests of others first. They don't accept a bribe against the innocent. Again, they're not doing something for their own gain. That's what that looks like. That's loving your neighbor. We see a picture of a believer in the Holy Spirit possibly going against the grain, behaving differently than others, shining. Like the saying, what's popular may not be right, and what's right may not be popular. If we're walking in the power of the Holy Spirit, if we've been abiding with God, we should be radiant and we should stand out. These things are worth contemplation, because the last line says, he who does these things will never be shaken. Because we as the branches are abiding in the tree that has the roots. We're building our foundation on solid ground. Martha was shaken. She came running to Jesus and tattled, don't you see what's happening? Tell her to help me. She was shaken, and it was because she was spending her time first on what she thought mattered, rather than starting at the feet of Jesus, being rooted in him and allowing the Spirit to lead and produce the fruit. I don't know where you are in regard to abiding in Christ. Maybe you're obeying, but you're not dwelling with him. Maybe you feel distance and need to reflect on how you're living, whether it's in busyness or rebellion. Maybe Jesus is knocking at the door and you haven't opened the door and invited him in because you feel like he's a stranger. And I hope maybe today you've heard enough to realize he's not stranger danger, and you can invite him in, and you can read his word and pray and ask questions and figure out who this Jesus is. Spend time with others who know him well. Maybe you know he's out there and you're not opening the door because you're angry. And it's time to hash that out. Invite him in. And like Psalm 13 gave us permission, share those thoughts with him. Maybe you heard the knock, you invited him in, you're excited about his presence, you offered him a cup of coffee and a place at the table. And then like Martha, you got distracted with something that needed to be done and you forgot he was there, waiting for you. I'm going to close this in prayer, and then I'd like to share a video of Bethel Music's No Longer Slaves. The song repeats, I am no longer a slave. I am a child of God. And for some of us, hearing that is wonderful, and we know what that means, and we find joy in that. For others, it's terrifying, because for some of you, your experience as a child was not, it brings some negative emotions, some negative feelings, feelings of mistrust. But we go back to remembering that our God is not, our earthly father is not a man. He is a perfect God. And that he is our perfect holy God and creator who can cast out all fear with love if we let him. He's saying, where are you? I'm here. Dwell with me, walk with me, abide in me, because you are my child, and I love you enough to die your death on the cross and give you my Holy Spirit so that you can walk in power and never be alone. I know you, and I have plans for you. Trust me. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your words, and we thank you for your love. We thank you that you are not a distant creator who has no interest in us. Thank you that you are allowing us into the most holy place to abide in your presence, God. Please forgive us, and we thank you for that forgiveness. Please give us the courage to trust you and to accept you and allow that to flow out to others. We pray for less pretending and more authenticity, less fear and more love, less hiding and more abiding. Amen.